Good morning, everyone. My name is Dan Gosling, the Chop Saver Guy, and I'm speaking to you live from the floor of the Midwest Band and Orchestra Clinic in Chicago, Illinois. We're in the exhibition hall. That's why it's a little loud in here, because there's about a bajillion instruments that people are trying and testing. So what we're going to do here, despite the din, and if you can't hear this, let us know and we'll adjust. But I'm here with good friend and phenomenal trumpet virtuoso, Tom Hooten, who is principal trumpet of the Los Angeles Philharmonic. And we had the distinct pleasure of hearing Tom perform as a guest principal with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra playing Shostakovich Fifth Symphony. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. We've already got a few questions that you folks sent in overnight. And I'm going to just start off by saying, Tom, thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Yeah,
it's just really awesome. This came together just in the last 12 hours.
Yeah.
So you're here. You also did a clinic yesterday, a little lecture. But
right.
You're also here to play with the orchestra.
Right.
You're principal of the LA Philharmonic, but you're acting principal of the Chicago, the famous Chicago Symphony. What is that like, and what other situations similar to that have you had to do recently?
First, hey, everybody. Thanks for having me. Yeah, this place is kind of crazy. Hopefully you can hear us. I've had the opportunity to guest a few other places, Kansas City, Indianapolis, New York Phil. And with Chicago, I did a couple weeks in September. You know, we all grew up listening to Chicago Symphony recording, so it's awesome. You know, it's sort of like a childhood dream. There's a guy playing second trombone this week, Jeremy Moeller, who I was in school with, and I said to him the other day, you know, if you would have told me when we were in school, you know,
right.
So it's really awesome. I mean, the orchestra sounds great. The brass section sounds phenomenal. And Gene and Charlie Vernon, oh my God, they're just great. I mean, everybody sounds phenomenal. So it's a great opportunity to learn how different orchestras sustain and phrase and like the different, the decibel level dynamic, but the dynamic, how different sections work with each other and how the hall works. So it's a challenge, but it's also fun. I mean, in some ways it's like getting in a different race car and saying like, how does this one drive, you know? So it's great.
Any particular differences like with the hall that are hard to adjust to on the fly, even though you got a rehearsal or two?
Yeah, I mean, the hall is a funny thing. I mean, it's like I was saying to a friend the other day, learning how you hear different parts of the orchestra, it's really a lot of depends on the hall. So sometimes I'm thinking, am I hearing the strings from where they are, or am I hearing more from a reflection of the hall, which plays a lot into where I place my notes, That's a challenge, and orchestras, you know, when they're in their own house, they get really good at that. So that's something I've got to be really mindful of, to try to adjust quickly, listening to my colleagues, but at the same time, I'm in a leadership position. So I'm trying to balance all of that out as quickly as I can and sort of talk with other people about, you know, just asking them. And it really talks, it really is the idea about a little bit about how leadership works, and it doesn't have to be all about follow me. Here I am, I'm gonna lay it down.
Right.
It's more of an interaction and a communication. And in this situation, I've gotta be open to that.
Awesome. So one of the questions from one of our Instagram fans was, has your embouchure changed over the years? And I love this question because I know that is a relevant question for Tom.
Yeah, so I want to write a book that's called 101 and Changing Embouchures. You know, something like that, because, yeah, it has changed. And I'd like to think that over the last 10 years it's become more efficient. And this is kind of a hard thing to put into words, like how has it changed? I would like to think that from the standpoint of balance, like what drives a healthy embouchure, air, but also that the air has helped me have a better sense of symmetry. And that sounds kind of weird, but it has changed. I think I've gone a little bit higher for me. I'm not saying higher is better for everybody,
right.
But I've got, basically, I've tried to get more and more lip into the mouthpiece. I sort of feel that the more lip you have in the mouthpiece, to some degree, is obviously different for everybody.
And you had some challenges in your college days.
Oh, yeah, of course. I had too much of a drag, and I was a little bit too low. The embouchure was kind of pinned spread apart. And so I've tried to alleviate the pressure that pinned that, and in that process, rebalance with a little bit more lip in the mouthpiece, and the air is captured in a more healthy way with the lips rather than pressure. If that makes sense. But I'm actually continually adjusting things and looking for, and knock on wood, somewhere I feel like the path I'm going is in the right direction.
So it doesn't freak you out that, hey, I'm changing my embouchure even though I'm where I am, and I should stick with what I've got. It's an organic evolution.
Yeah, I know. My friends in the LA Phil, they think I'm nuts.
Okay.
You know, I'll walk into the locker room, I'm like, guys, the embouchure changed 342. And and we laugh, and it's not really a change, but it's more like allowing for adjustments to be made. I sort of feel if the majority of the skills I'm using to make an embouchure are similar, a lack of too much pressure, healthy, and lined up airstream, then my embouchure isn't everything.
Right.
It's one ingredient.
Right.
So if I can make an adjustment in that, and then have healthy support from other parts of the equation, I feel like, oh, it's okay. Now I gotta do it with some degree of, I can't do too much.
Right. And does it ever happen like in a performance? Like
no,
in the beginning?
No.
I mean, you're not like,
this is a slow, conscientious awareness adjustment type thing. You know, it's not like, I definitely don't want to say, you know, for this passage I'm gonna use this. Not like
right,
that.
Right, right.
I'm looking for simplicity and consistency and something that's going to serve me for everything I have to be living. I know some people that do that switch around, but I definitely don't want to do that.
Okay.
I don't think I'm smart enough to do it.
All right, other question. How important is a set, or do you have a set routine?
I don't have a set routine. I have set ideas that I do. I mean, I do like the stamp, some of the stamps. So I've been doing stamp for years. But I have more set ideas. Working on response in the beginning of the day, you know, working on air and expansion, and then going through all the things that I would need. So I personally don't like a set ingrained.
Right.
But some students need that. Depending on where you are in your development, if you're in college and you're looking to have some sort of build a fundamental base, and why do we have a routine? That's the question. Like, what are the benefits from having a routine? And that is that you have the opportunity to reinforce a lot of good things over and over and over.
Right.
So if you feel that like you have a hard time reinforcing some basics, a routine is good for you. You know, like how to time the air in and out, and how to have good response in a measured, repeatable way, a routine is really good for you. So it's sort of different for every person, but I think in general it's pretty good, but I don't like the idea of set and fixed.
Right.
I want to be malleable so that I'm always sort of thinking about what results am I getting, am I going the right direction? If I'm not, then I'm going to adjust.
Yeah. Awesome.
We have a question from the commenters.
All right.
What mouthpiece do you use and what do you recommend?
What mouthpiece do I use? Okay. I use about the equivalent of about 1 1/4 C with a slightly drilled out throat and kind of like a symphonic back four. But
mouthpieces are very personal.
They're very personal, yeah, and I'm not really obsessed with it. It's what seems to work for me, but I probably feel like I could make several different mouthpieces work. I've always thought that the equipment isn't going to make me play better.
So let me ask you this. Do you use, if you're doing a pops, a really hard pops, you want something a little,
do you adjust
that way?
Yeah. If I have to do something where I'm going over like a concert E flat, then I will put in a smaller mouthpiece, and I'm still sort of searching for that. But over the years, over my development, over through college, there were times I played a 3C, I played a 5C. I was messing around, just seeing what mouthpieces would make it easier. And in that process, you sort of learn, like, wow, this is easier than this. I'm going to go back to my normal orchestra mouthpiece, and like, why is this so hard? What can I learn? What does that mouthpiece do for me? And can I achieve the same thing?
Right, interesting.
So,
I have a question. I've had the privilege of knowing Tom for a number of years. Actually, I had the privilege of performing with him in the Indianapolis Symphony, his first big orchestra job. And since then, he's got married, and now he has two beautiful children. And that is an adjustment that every musician has to figure out. How do I was so obsessed with this instrument, now I've got a wife and kids. How do I balance all that?
Yeah.
Interview number three.
It's a challenge. You have to be, I think it comes down to discipline. There are times, you know, at 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, on days that I'm not performing, that maybe my routine starts. It's just the way that I don't want to get into all the complications, but my week is sort of divided into two. I have half the week where I have normal nights, and the other half of the week I'm playing till 10:30 at night. And so, I just have to be aware, and I have to be disciplined about getting to the things that I, you know, how do you define discipline? It's doing what you should do, when you should do it, whether you feel like it or not.
Right.
So.
And yours is a little unique, because I should point out that Tom's wife is Jennifer Murata, a fantastic trumpet player in her own right. So you have two musicians who have to practice. You've got to be parents to your children. And you live in a big city where time is the essence, with the commute and all those kinds of things. So I'm sure you have to be a super good planner, and also deal with things in the moment when things don't go quite how you plan.
Exactly. Like, the idea of expectation is it's a four-letter word. Like, I'm expecting to practice at this time and it doesn't happen.
Right.
Or I expect a kid to take a nap and it doesn't happen.
Right.
So I think the other thing that's important is really notice how you use your time. Like, what is your, like, this is why I like that Seconds Pro app, right? I want to develop routines that people can, like, push play on an app. And, like, here's a routine that's 30 minutes, that's comprehensive, that has rest, and you actually get through a lot of stuff. Because I think, you know, back in college, I would have 2 hours, and I don't know if I really would get that much stuff done. It was a lot of wasted time. Not to say that you need to sometimes just throw yourself at it, but now I'm much more efficient. You know, I work in smaller chunks. It's like, I got that done, and I gotta go now.
You're right.
But I'll be back, and I'll get this, you know, checked in. So I think you can get a lot of things done in like a 10, 15 minute segment. You know, but sometimes they're not gonna be in a 2 hour session.
Right. Those are just luxuries that don't.
Yeah, you
don't
just
happen,
don't have that.
Right. Yeah. So I promised Tom this we wouldn't take a lot of his time. We're at about 15 minutes right now. I don't know if we got any other questions, but I'm going to ask one real quick one and then just do a little follow-up. I was also privileged enough to watch Tom's clinic yesterday, and one of the things he talked about was books. And it wasn't, you know, Arvin's Clark and performance books, or even performance anxiety books, although I'm sure there's some that you recommend. He recommended the Steve Jobs biography by
Walter Isaacson.
And why is that?
Well, I think the way that we have success in general is, you know, it permeates all different forms of careers and stuff like that. And I think I just try to look at some of the most successful entities in our human existence. I mean, obviously Apple and Steve Jobs changed our entire human experience.
Right.
And so what is it about that guy? Like, how did he come up with these ideas? What kind of passion, what drove him? And so, you know, listen to this, like, there's got to be something here I can learn and bring back to my music. And the thing I got from that book, actually ironically, meditation and leads to inspiration, leads to intuition, and leads to clarity. That's a lot. But you can see how that worked in his life, and for better or for worse.
Right.
So there are so many clues in other places, and if people have other passions, we need to learn how to, like, cross-pollinate in a way. You know, like, what can we learn from other places? There's so much there to learn from. Just get the blinders off, open it up, and see, and start with questions like, well, how could Steve Jobs' success as an entrepreneur and creative thinker transfer to my life?
Right.
And same thing with, like, Pixar, the Creativity Inc. by Ed Catmull. is an awesome book about how an organization works together and works through problems and tries to create new things. And how do we, here's the big thing, after you have success, should you do what you did before, or do I have to
adjust again?
Right.
Yeah.
You got to be really careful. You keep trying to repeat what worked.
Right.
Because there's a human condition to that that doesn't seem to work exactly the same. So it's really like Pixar has been amazing at that, and Steve Jobs was the president of Pixar for many years. I just like looking at other places, and it gives us a little bit more of a fresh idea.
Right. Not music all the time.
Yeah.
Well, Tom, this has been truly awesome. Where can people learn more about what you're doing? You have a website?
Yeah, tomhoop.com, and I do these workshops where I sort of explain a lot of this stuff, and I really love doing that. It's a mixture of audition prep and sort of the general mindset of how we approach our careers and life in general, and a little bit of how we manage nerves and performing experiences and auditions. So you can check that stuff out on my website.
Awesome. So it's getting a little noisier here as more people come in and try out their instruments. I want to thank Tom once again. I actually did an interview, a little longer form interview, a couple years ago with Tom. You can find that at chopsaver.com/blog, and then there, search July 2015. You'll find actually an hour-long interview chunked up into three parts. It's also on the ChopSaver YouTube channel under interviews. So with that, we're going to say so long from Chicago and the Midwest Clinic. Thanks for watching, and we'll try to archive this so it's viewable in the future. Thanks again. Bye-bye.